Let's bring it back here. All right. Did we accomplish our goal of little break plus burrito plus talking about the end times? All right. Good. Well, let's go ahead and pray as we dive into it today. Would you guys join me in prayer for this time? God, use me mightily this morning. God, I pray that I would be able to speak clearly and proclaim the word of God, and God, be able to teach this well, and also that we would walk away just with an understanding of this more and an encouragement from this, God, that you would allow us to know why this is in the word of God, why this is in Matthew, why this is in the midst of the series that you have us in right now, and what you have for us here today. God, I pray that we would not put meaning into the text that is not there, but we would only understand what you have for us. And God, it would lead us into deeper relationship with you, that it would allow us to see clearly the God that we serve, and that we would walk away from this being emboldened and enlivened and encouraged and just reminded to fix our eyes on you. God, we love you and thank you. Pour out your anointing on me today, that you would speak through me, that I would decrease and that you would increase. God, we love you. We love you. We love you. In your holy precious name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Well, the topic of end times for many is intense. I grew up in the church, and Vanessa actually pointed out something that was pretty clear. So how many of you guys saw Left Behind movies when they came out? Okay, Left Behind movies. So Left Behind movies, that was like our generation. And what's interesting, she's absolutely right. The kind of the purpose of these movies was to instill fear in people and hopefully bring them to Christ through fear, right? And that's not always the best tactic. But I think a lot of the reason why, even though I knew I was in Christ, but I had so much fear around this, because I watched horror movies about the end times as a kid, basically. And there was still this sense of fear, like everything is so fearful and dark. And I think there is some improper teaching, and there is some genuine kind of respect and a healthy fear that we're meant to have around this. And yet it's also supposed to be overcome by a sense of peace and security and knowing Christ. So obviously the reason that we're talking about this, the theological word is eschatology. Can anyone say eschatology? Eschatology. You guys know what eschatology means?
No.
It's basically your view of the end times. So eschatos is like last. Eschatology is the study of like what you believe, what your view of what's going to happen in the end time prophecies, right? And people are all over the map on this. And the truth is, they've kind of fallen into a couple different camps, and people are trying to make sense of all these prophecies because there is a lot said about the end times, but a lot of it's also veiled in mystery. And there's also a lot that's not said, right? So you get enough, and some of that is very, very clear. Some of that seems a little mysterious. Like Bob mentioned, there's people who have theories like, okay, well, the locusts are going to come. Well, locusts kind of look like a helicopter. So maybe the locusts are the helicopter and Russia is it. Like people always try and kind of put the pieces together and try and figure out how do we make sense of these prophecies in our time? Is it happening in our time? Have you guys heard more and more talk around this being the last days and Jesus coming back soon and all these signs are happening and all these things, right? Like, I get what you're saying, and it very well could be in this generation, but the truth is every generation's had their own version of that. Like the Jews went through the fall of Rome, right? Like imagine going through the Holocaust and thinking like, this is it. Like there's been some pretty big things that have happened, and all the while people are always kind of looking for these patterns. And I feel like as we're reading this, there's a really important thing that we're meant to get from it. I'm getting ahead of my notes, so once I get to that point, I might be confused later, but I want to tell you this now, okay? So when I stumble over my words later, you know why. There is a weird mentality that when we read this text, we sometimes think like, okay, this is just giving us a timeline of the end times. And there's this view that says it's really not applicable for us. It's really only applicable for this generation. So if you happen to be in the generation that this happens to, then it's really important that you know these things. But for everyone else, it's really just kind of, it's not important, right? I don't believe that's true. I don't believe that Jesus talks about the end times here. I don't think that Daniel prophesies about the end times here. Revelation, the entire revelation to John in Revelation, I don't think the point of it is just like, hey, ignore this and tell the final generation, then it's important for you to know this stuff. I think there's something we're meant to take away from it. So like, obviously, the second coming of Christ did not take place in the time of the disciples. It did not take place in the billions of believers up until now, the 2,000 years that have happened. It may or may not take place in our lifetime. And I think there are some things that are meant to be seen when this stuff happens, but there's also something that we need to take away from it now. There's a reason why God tells us this. This is not like when you're reading a book, like, ah, this doesn't apply to me. Okay, moving on. Like, I always do that. Like, whenever I'm reading the medical surveys, like, if you're drinking, but like, I don't drink, so I just skip over those few pages. I'm like, it doesn't matter to me. Like, I don't. So it doesn't, like, I don't have to worry about heavy machinery or opera. Like, I'm good, right? That's not what this is. This isn't like, oh, this doesn't apply to you. There's a reason this is in here. There's a lot that's going on, and oftentimes it can feel overwhelming. When growing up and going into my Christian education, there was this sense of fear surrounding the end times, not because I was on the wrong side, but because there's so much unknown and we fear the unknown. It's scary. We don't know. Like, at night when it's dark, part of the reason why people are afraid of the dark is you can't see what's going on. When it's daytime, you can walk through your house, no problem. When it's nighttime and a door's like cracked closed, and like you can see that sweatshirt hanging and you could swear it looks like a person with a knife getting ready to stab you. Like, we fear what we don't know, right? So when it comes to our eschatology, when it comes to our view of the end times, it can be scary. We watch movies, we see different viewpoints, and I think those viewpoints were well-intentioned. And I think there are some things that we can take away from movies like Left Behind and different sermons I've heard on the end times. But by and large, I think a lot of them miss the point of these passages. I think a lot of them ended up focusing so much on just this historical event of the second coming of Christ that they missed out on why Jesus was telling this to Christians now. Why we're meant to know these things. Why we've been revealed these things. Are we just supposed to safeguard these so that they make it to the end times? No. There's something to be taken away from this. Well, today we're in Matthew 24 and we see Jesus talk about the end times. We see him talk about the signs at the end and his return. And we need to be careful because as curious human beings, we can do something when something comes up that we don't know. We try and figure out what we don't know. So when we come up against something that doesn't tell us everything we want to know, we tend to focus on trying to solve the mystery rather than learn the lesson that's being taught. We focus on trying to solve the mystery rather than try and learn the lesson that's being taught. Probably one of the best examples is when the adulterous woman comes out and they're getting ready and they're saying, hey, Jesus, the law.
For my dad's brain, because this is what my dad would do at Shepherd when something like this happened. He would like scurry up the aisles and run with like new batteries or a new pack or something. This is great. All right. But I did not listen to his lesson and change the batteries before every service. Sorry, Dad. All right. Ready?
Back on one. Yeah. Check. There we go. All right, we're back. Thank you, guys. So, adulterous woman. She comes out. She was caught in the act of adultery. And the Pharisees said, Jesus, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. The law says she must be taken out and stoned. What's interesting is there's obviously takes two to tango, and the man was kind of missing from that scenario. So I don't know what's going on. But they took this woman out, and they said, Jesus, what do you say? They had their stones. They were ready to go, right? And the Bible says Jesus bent down. He started writing in the dirt, right? He stands up. He says, let him who is without sin be the first to cast the stone. This beautiful, powerful moment, right? Immediately, my curious brain is like, what did he write in the dirt? Right? Like, is that the point of the passage? No. You know how I know? Because it didn't tell you what he wrote in the dirt. There's a much bigger picture. But like, immediately when we don't know something, we're like, I've heard sermons like, well, we think he wrote this and he was pointing an arrow to the accuser. And I'm like, that's not there. Like, is that the point of the passage, right? Like, there's a very clear point. Like, there might be meaning from the fact that we don't know and that he was actually touching the dirt. Like, that might be there. But immediately when we don't know something, we try and just fill in the gaps. And I think we can do this with the end time stuff too. Where instead of trying to look at why Jesus is saying something, instead of looking at what is being said, we try and just pull out our timeline and be like, okay, I'm going to fill in all the gaps. I want to know exactly what this is. I need a name. I need an age. I need a social security number, like shoe size. Like, is he white, black, Hispanic? Like, I need to know who this is. I need to know all the details around the Antichrist and all this stuff. And some of those are there, but I don't think the point of this is for us to just get this detailed timeline. And yet today, we're going to look at a timeline, but not hopefully to help recreate, just to help us understand what's going on here and try and focus on what's being said. But I don't want us to miss the meaning and the purpose of what's happening here. So I want us to get a grasp on some of these things and maybe even spark in you a curiosity to dive deeper. But more than that, I want us to get the big picture of what's going on, the big picture of what Jesus is saying here and what we're meant to take away from this passage. So what we're going to do today, outline for those who are type A, we're going to walk through this passage together. It's a thick one. It's a dense one. So I have some pictures and some timelines that I think will help us understand this. And then we're going to zoom out and see what we're meant to take away from this. Because the whole point is I want to demystify some of these things and also not be afraid of them. Because I don't think being afraid of passages and skipping over them ultimately is what's best for our Christian walk. I did it and it was not healthy, right? Like when I was growing up, I grew up in the church. A five-year-old doesn't want to read about demons and end times and horns and bulls. Like, it's really hard. But part of that is because I didn't have the context to understand what was going on. So we're here. We're grown-ups. We're good. We can walk through this. We're going to hold each other's hand and try and understand what's going on here and find the encouragement that's meant to be from these passages, okay? So Matthew 24, starting in verse 1, is where we're going to start. Starting off, it says, Jesus left the temple and was going away. When his disciples came to him to point out the buildings of the temple. And he answered them, you see all these, do you not? Truly I say to you, there will not be left one stone upon another that will not be thrown down. So where were they? So I have a couple pictures on here. Let's pull up picture number one. So this is Jerusalem, okay? This is all the stuff that you got going on here. This is the Temple Mount. This is this raised platform that the temple was built on. This is the temple right here. This is the second temple, right? This temple had actually been revived by Herod. He spent 8 years just gathering supplies and materials to rebuild this temple. Now, that might seem great and great. Herod's a nice guy in favor of the Jews. Well, no, he actually did this with all the temples. He just wanted his region to be great, right? So Temple of Zeus, Artemis, all the temples underwent huge renovations. This temple right here, oh, nice. This temple right here was gorgeous. If you actually hear the writings of it, they say everything was covered in gold. And what wasn't covered in gold was covered in white marble that was polished so much that when you were actually looking at it from a distance, it looked like it had snow on the roofs. Like this was a gorgeous, valuable temple filled with tons of things, filled with gold in every crevice and nook and cranny. This was a gorgeous temple. These are obviously artist renderings. There was no one back there to take a picture. These are, like, over here you have this. Go back to the first picture of Jerusalem. So here you have this outer wall, right? So some of the highlights on here. Also, if you guys don't have a study Bible, you should get one. This is from that study Bible. It's just super helpful and super cool when you're reading text to be able to see it, right? So you have the gate. You have Herod's palace. You have the Praetorium Tower of all these people. Golgotha up here where Jesus was praying. You have the archives, North Gate. Bridges, gates, Bethsaida pools, right? The waters would be stirred up over there. The Pool of Israel, the Temple Mount. This was the path to the Mount of Olives, the Garden of Gethsemane. You have all these things over here, right? So this is the path to the Mount of Olives. So when it starts off this passage, it says the disciples are up going to the Mount of Olives. So they're coming up past here and they're looking down. So what are they seeing when they look down? Well, let's look at a picture of what it looks like today. Today, this is the view from the Mount of Olives, right? So you have the Temple Mount, but what's on the Temple Mount? Well, it's not the Jewish temple, right? So if you go back, this is the same perspective. It's a little bit different. You can go back to the ancient view. This is a little bit closer to what they would have seen. Obviously, no high rises and cranes in the background. They would have been looking down from the Mount of Olives, and you can see all of Jerusalem. You can see the Praetorium, you can see all of it, and standing in the middle, you can see this gorgeous temple, the Temple of Herod, filled with gold, filled with polished white marble, like gleaming in the sun. So the disciples say something pretty, they're looking about like, hey, Jesus, do you see the temple down? Like, look how beautiful it is, right? So you need to remember where they were, where they thought they were. So the disciples had their own eschatology. They had their own view of the end times. They had their own view of what was to come, right? The disciples did not think they lived 2,000 years ago. The disciples lived now, right? The same way that we might look to someone 2,000 years in the future, they were looking forward to us. They didn't know what to expect. So they thought four things were going to happen. They knew that the world would be in turmoil. So for them, check, Roman occupation, right? They're being imprisoned. They're being burdened by all these taxes. They've been overcome by Rome. They're basically living under this oppression. They knew that a herald like Elijah would come before the Christ came. One like Elijah. Well, who is that? John the Baptist. So especially these disciples. So they're saying, okay, so the world will be in turmoil. Check, Roman occupation. A herald like Elijah will be coming. Okay, check, John the Baptist. And then they thought the Messiah would appear defeating their enemies. So that means the world was in turmoil, but the Messiah was going to come and was going to defeat their enemies. What they thought this was going to mean was kill Rome, right? Maybe not kill, get rid of. So Rome, out of the picture. And then they thought that the scattered Jews would return to Jerusalem and the Messiah would set up his kingdom and Jerusalem would be at the center of it all. So in a very real way, looking down, number five. There we go. Not number five, number three. Looking down, looking and seeing the temple. From where they were, they thought they were between two and three, right? They knew that one like Elijah had come. And I think they knew that Jesus was the Christ, but he definitely wasn't overthrowing Rome. And they hadn't established Jerusalem as the center of it all, the Jews as leaders of the world. They hadn't seen that. And guess where they thought it was all going to be centered? Right here. So they're looking down. They're seeing this temple. They're saying, Jesus, you see those buildings? Like, this was a great source of pride. 46 years to build that temple. That's a long delay, right? 46 years to build that temple. And they're looking down and they're thinking, this is it. The one like Elijah has come. Like they think they're in this time that the Messiah is coming. They just didn't realize what it was going to look like. And that's evidenced by what Jesus says. What does Jesus say to him? You see all these. Truly I say to you, there will not be one stone left upon another. Wait, what? How? Hold on. Wait. No. What? I thought we were on the same page, Jesus. You're the Messiah. You're about to establish us. There's a temple right there. We can see. I thought, isn't this going to be centered? What do you mean it's going to be torn down? You see, they had a view of the end times, but they kind of didn't understand what it was going to look like. They weren't looking to the second coming of Christ. They were looking to the first coming of Christ. And Jesus, who knows it all, he's laying out for them a much bigger picture than they can see. Does the Messiah come and defeat their enemies? Well, yeah, but what enemy is the real enemy? Sin, death, guilt, condemnation. Like Jesus proves victorious over sin. The true enemy, not Rome, not Iraq, Iran, Afghanistan, like Russia, China, like it's not these nations. Like the true enemy is much deeper than just nations that rise and fall every couple hundred years. So they're looking down and Jesus says, listen, there's a day that this is all going to be torn down. And they're confused, so they ask a question, which I think is fair. Picking it back up in verse 3, it says, as he sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying, tell us when these things will be and what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age. And Jesus answered them, see that no one leads you astray, for many will come in my name saying, I am the Christ. And they will lead many astray. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not alarmed, for this must take place, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All of these are but the beginning of birth pains. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and put you to death, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will fall away and betray one another, and hate one another. And many false prophets will arise and lead many astray. And because lawlessness will be increased, the love of many will grow cold. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be proclaimed throughout the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. So this first section, I want to pause right here. This first section that we're in, this is what is often referred to as the church age. So what Jesus says to his disciples before getting into a couple things that we're going to see here, he says, listen, in this church age, in this age to come, this is after Jesus died, before he comes back for the second time, in this church age, this is what you can expect to see. He's saying, don't be troubled by it. Like, these things must happen. These are just the beginnings of birth pains. Like, this is what you're going to see. So much of this is being fulfilled. And I think for us, we go to, well, if this is happening, this is the end. No, this is just the beginning of the end. But yes, there is a falling away. Yes, lawlessness is increased. And in part, this is fulfilled every generation. It's happened many times, right? You've had the rise and fall. You've had revivals. You've had fall. You've had persecutions in the church. You've had Christianity become illegal. Like, we've seen this played out in part in many different ways. And Jesus says that's exactly what you should expect. As lawlessness increases, this is what you're going to see. And in this time, living in a broken world, shattered, fractured by sin, you can expect famine and earthquakes and wars and rumors of wars and nation rising against nation. Like, these things will happen. And the more lawlessness increases, the more this is going to happen. But it's just the beginning. And yet, even in the midst of the church, it says, listen, falling into the Great Commission, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you to. He follows in with saying, listen, the good news of this kingdom, the good news of the gospel, will be proclaimed to the ends of the earth, to all nations. There's going to be times of heartbreak. There's going to be times of famine and earthquake and wars. There's going to be some scary, heartbreaking things that happen. And yet in the midst of it, God is working to send the message of the good news of the kingdom of God to the ends of the earth. He's saying, listen, at the end of the age, when the good news has gone out to everyone, when everyone has heard the good news of the gospel, then the end will come. Now, this is not meant to be used by, hey, we have control over when Jesus comes back. So if we don't want him to come back yet, just don't preach to the ends of the earth. If we do, let's go preach to the ends of the earth because we want Jesus to come back sooner. That's not the point of this, right? Like, Jesus is telling you what will happen. He's not telling you, like, hey, you have control over this. Like, preach faster and I'll come faster. Like, that's not the purpose of this, right? Jesus is giving us an outline, but what's the main purpose that he sees here? Well, we're going to get into that in a little bit, but he's saying, see to it that no one leads you astray. The reason why he's doing this is he's saying, listen, when these things happen, there will be a tendency to be led astray in a couple different ways. Into fear, into distraction, into deception, into following false teaching and false leaders, into falling away, into taking on idols and following them. Instead, there's going to be all sorts of things. See to it that no one leads you astray. I'll let you know what you need to know. I'll give you this roadmap. I'll give you enough to know what's me and what's not me, and you can test it against what Jesus said and against his word. There will be many false teachers and false Christs. There will be rumors of wars and famines and earthquakes. But Jesus goes on, picking it back up in verse 15. He talks about the abomination of desolation. That sounds like a movie title right there, right? Maybe the next Marvel movie, The Abomination of Desolation. Although I don't think it's going to go well considering the trajectory they're on right now. So picking up in verse 15, it says, so when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by the prophet Daniel standing in the holy place, let the reader understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let the one who is on the housetop not go down to take what is in his house. And let the one who is in the field not turn back to take his cloak. And alas, for women who are pregnant, and for those who are nursing infants in those days, pray that your flight may not be in winter or on a Sabbath. For there will be great tribulation, such as not been seen from the beginning of the world until now. No, and never will be. And if those days had not been cut short, no human being would be saved. But for the sake of the elect, those days will be cut short. And then if anyone says to you, look, here's the Christ, or there he is, do not believe it, for false Christs and false prophets will arise, and they will perform great signs and wonders. Are they false signs and wonders? No. They're going to perform signs and wonders so as to lead people astray, if possible, even the elect. See, I have told you beforehand. So if they say to you, look, he's in the wilderness, do not go out. If they say to you, look, he's in the inner rooms, don't believe him. For as lightning comes from the east and shines as far as the west, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. Where the corpse is, the vultures will gather. So we see this timeline starting to come up, that there's this act that's coming, this abomination of desolation that Daniel talks about in Daniel 9 and Daniel 11. Not this Daniel, the Bible writer Daniel, right? He talks about the abomination of desolation, this human setting himself up in the temple as an abomination, right? And Jesus is saying, listen, there's going to be so much around that. Like, even when this happens, people are going to try and be like, hey, Jesus appeared to me. I know where he is. Like, come back with me and come, let's see him. Or he's in the wilderness. He appeared to this small group of people. Like, let's go see. He's like, no, that's not what's going to happen. Like, you don't have to be fearful. Like, it's going to be evident. There's going to be warnings. It's going to be clear. God's going to take care of his people. And when Christ comes, everyone's going to know it. There's not going to be a question. Like, listen, when lightning flashes across the sky, it's going to be in a moment. There is no like, oh man, I missed it. Like, I think it was here and he came and he took his people back, but I didn't go to that meeting and that club. I wasn't part of this cult. I didn't drink the Kool-Aid, so now I missed it. Like, that's not what's going on here, right? But do you see how many theories and how many different false doctrines this is going up against? Like, how many people in your generation have told you Christ is coming back on this day? You better get ready. There's people who took out massive credit card debt. They sold everything. They're like, Jesus is coming back, so we're going to live it up right now. Didn't happen. 80s, Y2K. Like, there's all sorts of theories about when Jesus will come back. And there's also always someone who claims to have figured it out. Let's look at picture 6 real quick. So I want us to see this timeline a little bit. And I want you to know, please research this. This is a view, right? Like, come challenge me on this. Like, I try to do as much digging as I can. There's only so much I can do, and this is like still a work in progress, but this is kind of an overview of what it is, and you can see the scriptures. I can send this to you afterwards. The scriptures that put these on there. So this is someone's interpretation, someone's view of the end times, and right here, they have the scriptures telling them why they believe that's what's happening. So if we walk through here, you've got the church age right here, right? So that's the church age. We're here. We're gathering together. Jesus has died. He rose from the dead. He established his church. He sent people on the Great Commission to go spread the good news of the gospel. He paid the price for our sins. And then after the church age, he's saying this view says there's going to be a rapture of all believers at the beginning of what's called the tribulation, right? So it's a 7-year tribulation. So this view is saying there's going to be 7 years of tribulation. So not just the normal church age hardship that we see and go through, but there's going to be 7 years of real tribulation. Within that 7 years, something called the abomination of desolation is going to take place. If you actually look at how this is broken up, 3.5 years, 3.5 years, there's some reason to believe that from some of the prophecies in Daniel, that halfway through, so the man of lawlessness, or the person who's going to be or set up the abomination of desolation, he's going to be revealed. And there's all sorts of things and prophecies that are going on in this 3.5 years, and there is some tribulation. And then it seems that about halfway through, this tribulation is going to go into a great tribulation. That's one view. Challenge me on it. Sure, let's talk about it. I can tell you why. We'll talk about it more, okay? So halfway through, you're going to go into this greater tribulation. This is this time when the abomination of desolation is set up, that in the temple, which is there a temple right now? No. But is there a group of Jews that is waiting for the day that they're able to build that temple? Absolutely. They have the funding. They have the supplies. They're literally waiting on the standby. They don't realize that as soon as they build it, it's going to be demolished. But no, there's people waiting to set up this temple, right? So there might not be a temple now, but we know there will be a temple. And in that temple, the abomination of desolation will happen. The man of lawlessness will set himself up. He'll make a deal with them. He'll be friends with them. And all of a sudden, he'll come in and actually desecrate the whole thing. So from that, we see Armageddon happening at the end of the tribulation. At the end of the 7-year tribulation, this battle, Jesus wins. He takes everyone home. The second coming of Christ. So in this rapture, Jesus is not returning yet, but he's actually coming on the cloud. So it takes everyone with him in heaven, comes down into the sky and brings up everyone from earth, and they all go into heaven together. This is the rapture that they talk about, right? So it's not the second coming of Christ is not the rapture. Like, Christ is coming to take his along with the angels to bring them back. And then the second coming of Christ is at the end of the tribulation. Then there's a 75-day period, which these are some of the things that might happen in the 75-day period. And they do that just because some of the math, that how it works out between different prophecies and the amount of days that they have. And then the millennial kingdom begins, the 1,000-year millennial kingdom. Great white throne judgment, new heavens and the new earth, right? This stuff isn't as much covered about what's going on here. We're really kind of focusing on this for what's going on today. And like I said, I think this can be helpful for us, and there's a reason I'm showing you this. Don't get too caught up in this. Like I said, this is not like Jesus didn't draw out a timeline and tell you. Like, this is people trying to make sense of what's said in passages just like this. But something that we see here is that Jesus is answering a question that his disciples asked. So don't forget that. Like, they asked, hey, what's going to be the signs of the end times? So very specifically, he's answering a question. But in the answer, he's also teaching and encouraging them. See, Jesus' prophecy has different levels to it, just like every prophecy throughout Scripture. The first part of this prophecy, the first part that Jesus talked about, the destruction of the temple, that actually did take place. In 70 AD, the Romans came in. They were tired of all the religious stuff, and they actually came in, and they turned every stone upside down, and they actually, there's stories that say they burnt everything because there was gold in between the marble and the walls and everything. And they set the fire so hot so everything would burn and the gold would melt. So every stone fell and turned over. The temple was destroyed. Is that all Jesus was talking about here? Well, no, I think it's pretty clear. There's a little bit more to it. And yet that was a fulfillment of this prophecy. So yes, it's fulfilled in part, but there's also a coming ultimate fulfillment beyond that. Similarly, many of the Jewish people had already read about the abomination of desolation. That was in Daniel, right? They knew the abomination of desolation. Many of them actually thought it took place in 156 BC. There's a guy by the name of Antiochus Epiphanes. Antiochus Epiphanes. Remember that name. That'll be on the test later. Antiochus Epiphanes. Antiochus Epiphanes believed himself to be Zeus reincarnate. He believed himself to be God. He thinks he deserved worship. So what he did was he actually went into the temple in 156 BC, and he set up a statue of Zeus, and he said, hey, you need to worship Zeus, aka me. How are you going to worship? Well, you take pig, and you kill it and spread the blood everywhere. What was unclean in Jewish culture? Pigs. Right? So they thought, like, man, that's the abomination of desolation. Like, of course, he sets himself up as an idol and a god. He claims to be God, to be worshipped, and he desecrates this whole place. Like, he defiles the temple. Like, in them, that was the abomination of desolation. And yet what Jesus says here is, no, there's another coming one, right? It is in part. There is this pattern that we see on repeat, and there is partial fulfillments of all this, right? So you ask this question, well, is Russia the great nation? Is this what they're talking about? Maybe, but not maybe not ultimately, right? Like, think about living through the fall of Rome. Think about living through all these different nations that are rising and falling and trying to make sense of all this, like in part maybe, but there is an ultimate one that's coming. And at the end of that age, Jesus is coming back. Jesus is bringing with him everyone from heaven, taking with him all the elect, all the believers from earth, and they're going in the clouds. And that tribulation is going to begin. With Antiochus and the abomination of desolations, it was a partial fulfillment, but it was a foreshadowing of the ultimate and future fulfillment that is prophesied. And then we come to the end of our passage today, picking it back up in Matthew 24, verse 29. Jesus says, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will give its light, and the stars will fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then there will appear in heaven the sign of the Son of Man. What is that? A big banner. I don't know. There's a lot of signs that are on here, but there's obviously debate over what that sign is exactly. And all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send out his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds from one end of heaven to the other. So in here we see, where's Jesus coming back? Right where they were standing. The Mount of Olives, where he went away, he's coming back in that same place. But what we see here is Jesus also giving them encouragement. So what he seems to be talking about here, if we pull up number 6 again, he seems to be talking about the rapture, right? When Jesus comes in with a sound of a trumpet and he gathers up his people. But there's actually a couple of views that come from this. I will tell you where I currently tend to land, right? I'm not going to use final language because this is obviously a work in progress, but trying to make sense of the text, especially in studying this, where I think this might be my view, although if you have good reason that it shouldn't be, let's talk about it. We'll form it together, all right? Coming up to the next picture, number 7, there's actually 3 views of the rapture. So there's pre-tribulation, mid-tribulation, and post-tribulation, right? So these 3 views, there's great Christian scholars who believe all 3 of these. This is a secondary issue. Ultimately, we don't know ultimately what we believe or choose to believe. It doesn't change anything. It doesn't matter. I want us to walk away from some meaning in this. And yet, I do think having some clarity around this might help us not steer clear of these passages like we have, but actually embrace them and understand what's going on here. So the pre-tribulation says this rapture that Jesus is talking about is going to take place before, that God's going to spare his believers, that he's going to take with him all the believers before that 7-year tribulation begins, before the man of lawlessness is revealed, before all that stuff's going on, right? The second view says it's going to happen right in the middle. Now, before I preached this sermon, I was probably here, right? After doing studying, I feel like there might be a view of here that I start to understand a little bit more, where there is a sense of tribulation, that the man of lawlessness is revealed, that things do start getting worse, but it's still not the great tribulation. The great tribulation is that second half, after the abomination of desolation. Because when I see this passage and I see, it says, after the tribulation of those days. Now, there's a view that says the tribulation of those days is the church age that he's talking about, right? It's just all the stuff that takes place in here, all that tribulation. It's not the tribulation, it's just tribulations. That might be the view too. I'm somewhere between these two, right? Or there is a time that, like, you see these things that are coming, that Jesus gives us these warnings that the tribulation has begun and things are going to get worse. But then the great tribulation occurs. You see, after Jesus raptures up his people, that's when we get into the bowls and the trumpets. And if you read Revelation, there's some wicked stuff in there, right? Locusts coming from the ocean. Like, there's some hard stuff. I believe if this is that view, that stuff would be taking place in the second 3.5 years. Now, I don't want to get too caught up on this. I'm just trying to be transparent with you guys and actually say something and not just talk around it. I tend to be right here after reading these passages. Let's talk about it later, okay? The post-tribulation says we're going to be here for all of it. After all that really, really bad stuff, then God's going to take us back with him, and it's all going to be okay, and we're going to recognize all this. I don't tend to believe this. I don't tend to think that this fits with Scripture as much. Somewhere between those two. Cool? Are we on the same page? Yeah. All right, cool. So what do we do with all that? Well, I love the history. I think we've demystified some of the mysteries surrounding the end times. Please do more research. Go read Revelation. Go read Daniel 9 through 12. You can kind of read more about what's in there. You can actually read Paul, which we're going to do a little bit more next week because we're fleshing this out a little bit more. Paul writes to the church in Thessalonica, in 2 Thessalonians, where people were starting to get fearful and starting to panic around the end times, and he gives them some encouragement, which is part of the reason why I tend to find myself in the second view, where he says, listen, don't panic. If something that we've said or something someone else says is making you fearful of, like, it's happening, we don't know what's going on, it's like, listen, no, there's signs. There's signs that are going to happen. There's things that are going to take place before that. Don't worry about it. And even if it was a complete surprise, like, you shouldn't worry about it anyway, right? There's things you can do. There's things you can set up now that you don't have to be panicking about that. You can be ready for it when it comes, and that's going to be the main theme of next week's sermon. But like I said, I don't think this was written just so that the disciples would say, hey, in the future, this is going to be applicable. For the last 2,000 years, I don't think everyone's like, hey, this is good stuff. We've come up with timelines. It doesn't apply to us, but hey, take this, keep it running. There's meaning here. There's purpose here. There's a reason why Jesus gave this to us. I believe there's a purpose behind the end times prophecy that is meant to help us with our walk here and now. In fact, I think Jesus even sets up his disciples at the start of this passage with some insight into that purpose, with don't be led astray. Yeah. Right? Like, they ask, like, hey, what are the signs of the time? He's like, hey, don't be led astray. Like, in a sense, what's the purpose of everything Jesus is about to say? Don't be led astray. This is what's going to happen. Don't freak out. Did Jesus give them an exhaustive list of every single thing that's going to happen, all the prophecies? That wasn't the time or the place. God's given us that. That wasn't the time or the place. He's just helping them flesh this out a little bit more. But the dominant thought, as we close out some application points, we're done with the history part. If you didn't like this part, you can wake back up. We're going to do some more application stuff, okay? God gives us enough information about the second coming so that if we are in Christ, we don't need to fear and we don't need to be led astray. He gives us enough information about the second coming that if we are in Christ, we don't need to fear and we don't need to be led astray. I do think there is a witness potential here. I do think there is something about reading about these end times that hopefully would encourage you to come to Jesus, to actually see him for who he is, to recognize the great gift that you have in salvation from sin and condemnation and punishment. And yet for the believer, the point of this is that we would know that we don't have to be led astray and that we would know that we don't need to fear because these are realities. These things will happen, but we don't need to be afraid. The first point when Jesus is looking down at the temple, point number one, earthly kingdoms will not last forever. But whose kingdom does? Well, David said in Psalm 145, your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom and your dominion endures throughout all generations. In Revelation 11, it says the seventh angel blew his trumpet and there were voices in heaven all throughout saying the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and his Christ. And he shall reign forever and ever. So the first part about all these is like, listen, it's all going to dust. That's why Jesus says what he does about money and treasures and where he's like, listen, all these little empires, America, Europe, Russia, China, like it's not going, like these aren't ultimate things. The ultimate reality is that Christ is coming. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. That's what's being set up. This is echoed in Daniel 4 by a pagan king. It's one of my favorite passages where Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were their pagan names, but Hananiah, Azariah, and Mishael were their God-given names, right? So they were just thrown into the fiery furnace. Nebuchadnezzar, who believed that he deserved all glory and honor and praise because he believed, once again, that he was God, he built a giant statue of himself and said, you all have to worship me, I'm your king. He believed that his kingdom was going to be an everlasting kingdom. He believed that he was the one in charge of it all. He sent these three young men into the fire to be killed because they refused to bow down to the statue. And God showed up with them in the fire. They threw in three, they see four. And they call out to them, they come back and they're unsinged. And in that moment, with just a glimpse of God's power, with just a glimpse of who he is, King Nebuchadnezzar echoed that passage in Daniel 4 that says, truly, the kingdom of your God is an everlasting kingdom that will never be destroyed. A pagan king says that about God, seeing a sliver, a glimpse of what he can do. This God who can make the sun stand still, this God who created the heavens and the earth and everything in them, this God who created you and me, who created the laws of physics and the universe and the galaxies and all the stars, he created all of it. He is the God who is for us and not against us. He's the God establishing his kingdom forever. Earthly kingdoms will not last forever. Point number two, do not be led astray by false teaching, but be rooted in the word of truth. Don't be led astray by false teaching, but be rooted in the word of truth. I have to believe that when Jesus was saying this to the disciples, he was knowing what Matthew was going to write down. He was knowing what Luke was going to write down. He's saying, listen, this is for you, and this is for the generations to come. Don't be led astray. Know these things. When people start claiming, like if you are on social media, I don't know, the algorithm picked up something on my phone. I'm seeing like all these Christian end time prophecies of just Moderna's the beast and just like all different things that are coming up, right? Like everything all over the place. But when you hear it, you're not helpless. You're not left. I'm like, well, maybe it's true. Maybe it's not. I don't know. What do? Go to the word of God. Christ is coming back tomorrow. This is happening. Okay, well, let's look at this. Let's compare. Let's not panic. let's look at what the word of God says. Maybe it's true, and even then, we don't panic. The word of truth is given. You can test everything up against it. 1 Thessalonians 5:20 through 21 says, don't despise prophecies, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. What are you testing? Against the word of God. Throughout the scriptures, it says, listen, if a prophecy comes true, that's not the test of whether it's from God or not. If it leads you to God, if it aligns with what God has already said, if it's true in his word, that is the test of a prophecy, whether it's true or not. People make predictions all the time that come true. Some of them are from demonic forces, to be honest. Some of them are broke clocks being right twice a day, right? I can make a prediction that a stock will go up, and if you give it enough time, eventually it'll go up because that's how money works, right? Like sometimes that's what it is, but there are some things that are going on. So don't just say because it's miraculous, because it's supernatural, because it's spectacular, it's from God. That's not true. It even says there will be signs and wonders that take place. that show that it's not true. Real signs and wonders, not false signs and wonders, real signs and wonders that aren't true. They're a false doctrine. 1 Timothy 6, 3-5 says, if anyone teaches a doctrine and does not agree with the sound words of our Lord Jesus Christ and the teaching that accords with godliness, he is puffed up with conceit and understands nothing. He has an unhealthy craving for controversy and quarrels about words. I have encountered that and I have been that. Which produces envy, dissension, slander, and evil suspicions and constant friction among people who are depraved in mind and depraved in truth, imagining that godliness is a means of gain. If this becomes just about being right and not about knowing God more, we miss the point. Yeah. If this becomes about coming up with, well, yeah, I know it's not in the Bible, but just trust me. I know I have experience in this. I have my traditions. This is like, no, test it against the word of God. Yeah. It's not going to go against it. Yes, we have experiences. Yes, we have emotions. But those don't trump the authority of Christ. They fall under the authority of the word of God. All the time, people will, I know the Bible says that, but I just feel like this is what's right for me. You can feel that way. It doesn't make it true. Mm-hmm. Don't be led astray by false teaching, but be rooted in the word of truth. Point number three, the stakes are real. I think a big reason why we have this, we know that kingdoms are going to be torn down. We know that we don't need to be led astray by false doctrines, that we can test things against the word of truth, but the stakes are real. That's a big reason why we have this. We see this not because one day it'll be applicable. We need to know the stakes are real now. Heaven and hell are realities, not just options, not figments of our imagination, not fictional things. This passage just scratches the surface. If you read Daniel 9 through 11 in Revelation, you'll see all the things that are to come. And if you have not given your life to Christ, there should be a genuine fear of the things to come. But that fear doesn't have to stay there. You see, that fear is meant to be leading you into a free and loving invitation. The God who created the universe and everything in it, including us, has given us warning after warning, chance after chance, and most importantly, invitation into life to surrender to him and to have freedom from sin, to admit that we're sinners, to believe in Jesus and confess him as Lord, and to walk away from that fear and walk into the love of Christ. The stakes are real. And that brings me to the last point, point number four. If you are in Christ, you don't need to fear. Amen. I think this is that peace that passes understanding. Listen, I was telling Walter earlier, it's kind of like when you get stabbed with one of those fake knives. Have you seen those? Like the retracting blades? Like you might know that you know that you know that it's fake. Like I test those things 100 times, but when someone puts that into my gut, there's still like right? There's still this fear. You know that everything's going to be okay, but there's still this fear. I think, yes, there's still going to be a little bit of that sometimes surrounding the end times. I get that. We're human. Like, you can't read about locusts coming up from the oceans and swarming the earth and not be a little fearful. And yet, beyond that, there is a peace that passes understanding. There's a hope that God is in control. There's a trust that Christ has got it. God's got it. God's got a plan. 1 Thessalonians 5, 1-11. Paul writes to the church in Thessalonica. He says, now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers, you have no need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying, this is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman. I'm sorry. And they will not escape. But you are not in darkness, brothers. For that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light, children of the day. For we are not of the night or of the darkness. So then let us not sleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night. Those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, since we have seen, since we know, that's me, that's not this. Since we belong to the day, since we know, since we've seen, let us be sober. Having put on the breastplate of faith and love and the helmet of the hope of our salvation. For God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build one another up just as you are doing. There's a purpose to these passages. It's meant to allow us to encourage one another, to build one another up. We see things that the world doesn't see. We believe the word of God is the word of God, and it gives us a hope for tomorrow. And that leads us into a life that is ready. And that's exactly where we're going to pick up next week in verse 32. As we await, as we prepare, as we are ready to be taken up anytime, as we live lives worthy in expectation of that calling. Let's pray. God, I pray that I was faithful to your word. God, as imperfect as I am, I thank you that you are perfect. God, I thank you that this church is not about me at my best or at my worst. It is all about you. So God, do in us what only you can do. Allow us to trust you and understand these things all the more so that we might enter into deeper relationship with you. Trust you more fully. Be encouraged, not walk around with a shroud of fear over our eyes or just in terror, but God, walk in the victory of who you are and encourage one another and build one another up. God, we love you and thank you. In your holy precious name we pray. Amen. Love you all. Be blessed and be a blessing. There's lots of burritos. So.